So here, we want to find the maximum or minimum of the value of the quadratic equation. Quadratic function just means that it has a square as our highest exponent. So like x squared in pretty much all the cases we do. And you can only have one, either a maximum or a minimum. And if you recall from yesterday, it has a maximum if the a value is negative, meaning the parabola goes down. And it has a minimum if the a value is positive, because the parabola would go up then. And it would be those two points, part of the notes I made you write yesterday. Okay. So to find that point, even without writing it, I know that the a value here is 1, the number in front. So I know that a value is positive, so I'm going to find a minimum value. Okay, it just matters what that is. First thing I need to go ahead and find is the x coordinate of the vertex. Okay. And I'm going to go ahead and do that by doing using our formula, negative b over 2a. So I plug that in, and I get negative 4. Here's our b value, negative 4 over 2 times a, and a again is 1. So I get negative 4 over 2, and that's negative 2. So that is the x-coordinate of our vertex. And I would write that as negative 2, and then I need to find the y value. And that y value is the maximum or minimum point, in this case, the minimum point. Okay. So to find the y value of the vertex, I need to go ahead and substitute what we just found. I found that x is equal to negative 2. And I need to substitute that into our original equation right here. Y equals x squared plus 4x minus 3. So I go ahead and plug that in. I get y equals x squared, so negative 2 squared, plus 4 times negative 2 minus 3. I work that out. Negative 2 squared would be 4. 4 times negative 2, I get negative 8 minus 3. 4 minus 8, I get negative 4, minus 3, and I get negative 7. Okay. And again, from yesterday, the y-coordinate of the vertex is your maximum or minimum point. On our graph here, if I were to just draw kind of a rough sketch, again, this isn't really the parabola, but here would be our minimum point. The parabola is going up because a is 1. So negative 7 would be our minimum point of the graph. Okay. And we want to state that there. Negative 7 is the minimum. All right, next, if you can go ahead and turn to page 33 of the workbook, and we'll go over any questions you might have on the classwork and from yesterday. Again, make sure to ask if you didn't get a question. Now's the time to ask. If you didn't get it, probably others didn't get it as well, so you'd be helping other people. Number one did have a typo there. I know it's that should be D, but it was neither of those anyway. Okay. Yes, question? Number two, okay. Number two said, what are the zeros? Of the function f of x equals 9x squared minus 16. Okay. Here, don't be scared by this f of x thing. It's just like a y. Just another variable. It's not x at all. Don't think it's that. It's a function of x. Really, we only need to concentrate on this side. Again, we're trying to find the zero, so we're actually replacing that with zero. Remember from yesterday that the zeros, and if you didn't get this down, make sure to write it right now. Zeros can be written many ways. We can write it as solutions, x-intercepts, and even the word roots falls under that. So all four of those in this context mean the same thing. Okay, they're interchangeable. So to solve this, I can either use quadratic formula or I can use factoring. This is a good candidate for factoring because it's a perfect square. And I know it can be factorable because looking at the answer choices, all the answer choices don't have a square root or a complex number, so it must be factorable. Okay. So if I want to go ahead and factor this out, this would be a difference of squares. It is 3x squared minus 4 squared. Or you can also ask yourself, well, what would multiply to 9 times negative 16 is negative 144. And our middle number, well, there isn't a middle number. There isn't an x term. So we would say that's a 0. What multiplies to negative 144 and adds up to 0? And that would be negative 12 and positive 12. Okay, so you can go that route too. It's the same idea. It's a little better if you identify that it's a difference of perfect square. This is a perfect square, and that's a perfect square there, right there. And we just write that out. It's 3x minus 4 times 3x plus 4 equals 0. Okay. And these are really two different ways to solve that one right here. This would be the same. It would be x minus 12 and x plus 12 equals 0. And then they'll have that first coefficient of 9, so I need to divide these both by 9. Here I would get x minus, simplify that, and I get 3 over 4. Oops, not that. 4 over 3. And here I get x plus 4 over 3. So either way, you get the same thing. I need to bring these 3s up. But here I'm solving, so I just want to change the signs. And I get x equals 4 over 3 and negative 4 over 3. Again, same thing here. You would get 3x minus 4 equals 0 and 3x plus 4 equals 0. Solve those two equations, add 4 and divide by 3, and you get the same thing. X equals 4 over 3. And x equals negative 4 over 3. Okay, so either the four-line method of factoring, or if you did the box method in, or using a table in Algebra 1, or you could just identify it as a difference of squares and factor it out, which is the best way in this case, probably. Okay, other questions on the classwork from yesterday? Any other questions there? Okay. All right, so let's look at the next one there. Number 7. Okay. Number 7 says, if the solutions of a quadratic equation... So again, that word comes up. That means a lot of things. Okay. The solutions being, again, the zeros or the x-intercepts or the roots. Those all are interchangeable in this case. Okay, so if those are the solutions or zeros or the x-intercepts or the roots of the quadratic equation are 6 and 11, at what points does the graph of the related function cross the x-axis? So they're asking, well, where does that parabola touch the x-axis? What are these two points here? Well, we know it definitely has to do with the 6 and 11. And at those two points, our y value would be both 0. Those are our x-intercepts would be the easiest one to look at there. At the x-intercepts, the y value is always 0. So we're looking for where it's 6, 0 and 11, 0. And that would fall under this case right here, D. So look over one more there, number 4. Number 4 said the graph of the function is equal to x squared minus x minus 3 is shown below. Between which two consecutive integers does one of the solutions of the equation fall? Okay. And again, those solutions are what we just talked about there, where this parabola intercepts the x-axis or the x-intercepts. So we're talking about these two points right here. And we want to know between which two consecutive integers does one of those fall. So for each one of those, we can get an answer. Okay, so let's look at this one. Well, this one is between negative 2 and negative 1. And this one is between 1, 2, so between 2 and 3. And we'll see which one of those is the answers. And that's right here. A, and the other one's not on there, so just A, 2 and 3. This solution falls between the two consecutive integers, 2 and 3. Somewhere in between there, like 2.5 or 2.3. Okay. Yeah, question? Number 8, okay. This will be the last one we go over here. Number 8 says Monique found the zeros of the function. Okay. So zeros being our key word there. And they are, they just give them to you, negative 1 over 6 and negative 3. What are the roots of the equation? Okay. Well, as I've been saying, the zeros and the roots are the same thing. They're just synonyms for each other. So those are the same thing there. Negative 1 over 6 and negative 3. So those don't change at all. Those are interchangeable, so you get the same thing. All right, moving on there, let's go over. We're going to continue looking at parabolas. And for this example here, we're going to go ahead and graph a parabola. We're going to graph the equation Let's use f of x just because they've been using that a little bit, but that's just a y. It's not f times x or anything like that. Okay, we're going to go ahead and graph f of x equals 1 half x squared minus 2x plus 1. Okay, and while we graph, we want to name all the important parts. We want to find the zeros. We're going to find the y-intercept. We're going to find the vertex. All those key facts there. Okay, so we need to start with the vertex first. Okay. And the vertex, to do that, we find the x-coordinate of the vertex. We just say x is equal to negative b over 2a. That's our first part there. And we just plug in the values. So here's a, b, and c. And we go ahead and plug in those values. Negative 2 divided by 2 times a, which is 1 half. Well, negative 2 would be positive 2. And 2 times 1 half would just be 1. And 2 divided by 1 would be 2. So that's our x-coordinate of the vertex. So far we have the point 2 comma y. I need to find that y value or f of x value. We'll call it f of x for this case because that's what I use in the original problem. Even better, we're actually finding f of 2. We're plugging in 2 for x. So the function, we plug in 2, and that's just what that means right there, f of 2. Okay. Then next, we go ahead and just substitute x equals 2 into the equation. We get f of 2, plugging in wherever we see an x, we put a 2. And we work that problem out there. We get 1 half times 2 squared would be 4 minus 4 plus 1. Half of 4 would be 2. And I get 2 minus 4 plus 1. 2 minus 4 would be negative 2. And negative 2 plus 1, I get negative 1. So f of 2 would be negative 1, and that would be give my whole thing, my whole vertex there. I get my vertex is going to be 2 comma negative 1. Then I'm ready to go ahead and start the graph. Okay. Yes. That could go up a little bit. Yeah. This one, 2 squared would be the 4. I just plug in 2 wherever x, I'm substituting 2 for x, and I get 4, 2 squared, I get 4, and then half of that will be 2. Okay, so I'm ready to go ahead and graph that. 2 comma negative 1, that would be, we're saying instead of x is just the f of x, and this is the x-axis. Again, really meaning the same thing, just y and x, nothing's changed really. And we go ahead and graph that. 2 over and down 1. And that would be my first point there. That's my vertex point, 2, -1. I'll give you a second to go ahead and graph that out if you haven't already. All right, next I want to go ahead and use my a value to get 2 more points on the graph. So in this case, my a value was 1/2. So I have to go over 1, always over 1 with our parabolas no matter what. So over 1 on both sides. And then the a value here is what I dictate to go, how much do I go up or down from going over 1. So I go over 1 no matter what. And then a is 1/2, so I just go up 1/2, not a full one, right in the middle there. I do that on both sides, go over 1, up 1/2. Okay, so when you have a fraction, it's no different really. You still go over 1, and then you just do whatever the a value says. And so in this case, it says +1/2, so I go up 1/2. Next, I want to get a few more points. One of the points that we looked at yesterday is the easiest point in standard form. It is the y-intercept. The last number right here is just your y-intercept. So in this case, it'd be 1. Our y-intercept would be the point 0, 1. Why is that the y-intercept? Because my parabola hits the y-axis, then the x value is 0 at that point. And if I plug in 0 for both of these, they cancel out and I just get 1. So on my graph, I'm going to graph that point as well. The y-intercept would be 0, 1, and that would be right here, up 1 from the origin. And again, my y-intercept right there, the point 0, 1. Okay. Then the last two points I want to get are right on the x-axis. I need to go ahead and find my zeros or the x-intercepts. And to do that, I need to go ahead and just solve that equation out, equal to 0. I need to find those x-intercepts. So I set my original equation, 1/2 x squared minus 2x plus 1 equal to 0. Fortunately, the Pascal problems you could factor, but this one you cannot factor out. We need to go ahead and instead, will be difficult to factor. It'd be easier to use our quadratic formula. And we're going to go ahead and use that here. X is going to equal negative b divided by 2a. Negative b plus or minus square root of b squared times 4ac. And we're going to just plug in our a, b, and c values in there. Here's a, b, and c again. And we're going to plug them in. So I get x equals negative, negative 2, plus or minus the square root of b squared, so negative 2 squared, minus 4 times a, which is 1 half, times c, which is 1. All over 2 times a, and a is again 1 half. So I go and work that out. Negative negative 2, I'll get positive 2. Plus or minus the square root of negative 2 squared before. Negative 4 times a half, I'll get negative 2. All divided by 2 times 1 half, I get 1. I work that out. I get 2 plus or minus 4 minus 2 would just be square root of 2 there over 1. I don't need to write that. Dividing by 1 doesn't change anything. So my two x-intercepts or my two zeros would be 2 plus square root of 2 and 2 minus square root of 2. And to graph them, we want to go ahead and estimate these as best we can. Square root of 2, well, square root of 2 is between square root of 1, which is 1, and square root of 4, which is 2. So it's in between 1 and 2, a little bit closer to 1. So let's say we estimate it at maybe 1.3 or 1.4. Okay. Because it's a little bit closer to 1, it wouldn't be exactly in the middle. So if I estimate about 1.4, I'll get 2 plus 1.4 and 2 minus 1.4. And I get x is approximately 3.4. And the other x value there, the x-intercept, would be approximately 0.6. And I'm going to use those two to graph. I'll get my 2 points, 3.4 comma 0, and 0.6 comma 0. So I go ahead and graph those two. 3.4, so I go over 1, 2, 3, and then a little bit more. Right about there. 0.6, a little over right there. I get my 2 points. This one being about 3.4 comma 0, and this one being 0.6 comma 0, the two x-intercepts or the zeros there. And I have a lot of points to go ahead and make my shape of the graph, and that's the last thing we're going to do there. Go ahead and draw the graph through those points. Okay. Probably a little wider. Again, that's because we had a fraction for a. A was a small value, 1/2. So we get a wider parabola than normal. So we have all our key parts of the parabola listed. We got our y-intercept, we got the vertex, and we got the zeros or the x-intercepts. Okay. Let's add in one more thing. The last part there I want to talk about is the line of symmetry that goes right through the vertex. We usually make that as a dashed line. So if you can add that to your drawing of a parabola. And the line of symmetry is a very easy equation, and you can draw it very simply just right through the vertex. It's a vertical line through the vertex. And vertical lines have the equation where it's just x equals some number. And since it's going through this x value 2, it'd be the equation x equals 2. That's the equation of the line of symmetry. Okay, it's just x equals whatever the value of the x value in the vertex there, in this case 2. So to kind of recap, the first thing you want to do is find the vertex, do the negative b over 2a part, get that value, then go back and plug it in. Then use your a value to get two more points. Get the y-intercept. It's just the last number. Plot that point. And then lastly, either use quadratic formula or factor if you can, and get the zeros and graph them, and then draw the axis of symmetry going right through the vertex and write down what that is. It's just x equals whatever number in the x coordinate right there, in this case 2. All right, so just a few questions for classwork here. Okay, so for each of those, you need to graph each and find the vertex by using the negative b over 2a. Find the y-intercept, which is the last number. The x-intercepts, you need to set equal to 0, and then you use quadratic formula or try to factor. And then draw the line of symmetry. It's just the number that you found for the vertex, the x part. X equals that number. A little dashed line right through the vertex horizontally or vertically.